Paul gives us 7 points by which we become effective in the marketplace as royal priests. May I also tell you that it is through this that our personal needs are also met, that we get financial breakthroughs. It is through this that we get injection into our pocket where monies are concerned, and wealth, and all we need to be effective in the kingdom. It says, number one, prophesy. You cannot prophesy if you've not heard from God. Hallelujah. Some people look at you and they prophesy. But you cannot look at people and prophesy. You must have done your holy priesthood work properly, because you prophesy amiss. Sometimes we look at people and the way they present themselves, we tell them things. But the fact of the matter is that you don't judge a book by the cover. I've told you this story before. A powerful young minister went to preach in a church convention, and he was single. So the lady that sang before he preached, very, very pretty lady, long eyelashes, long hair, lovely, pedicure, the hands is manicure and the feet is, okay, it's pedi and money together. Money and pedi together. Hallelujah. Things were looking good. And he turns to the host pastor and he says, is the girl married? They say, oh, it's a single girl. So I love her. So anyway, the pastor became a betweener, what you call it, when we were growing up, a cupid, and connected the two. Cut a long story short, they ended up marrying. The marriage was a powerful thing. Chandeliers were swinging. Choirs were singing in tens. The vows was powerful. Everything was great. Now, this is a person that believed that God said to him that the lady singing was the wife. So they went to the honeymoon after the wedding ceremony. The man of God, the prophet of God, was relaxing, waiting for the wife to come from the bathroom, and he kept shouting, honey, they said, honey, hold on, I'm coming, please. I'm ready. I've been waiting for you all my life. You are the only mosquito in my net. And the woman just turned up. He said, I think somebody invaded the room. He said, what are you talking about? It's me. I said, no, what happened to your eyelashes? I said, oh, I took it off because I really want to do stuff. I said, no, what happened to the hair? I said, it's in the bathroom. They said, what? Your fingers? What else? I took everything off. I said, no. Please sing. Sing, at least that can confirm to me if that was the same lady I got married to. If you look at people by their appearance, you tell them in the bedroom, please sing. Glory to God. If you say God spoke to you, then surely you must hear from God. A lot of times people prophesy, but it is not got any basis. We say things in the church, our commitment to church, our commitment to our husbands and wives, our commitment to things God has called us to do. And because we have not had proskuneo, we can't have effective lateria. Because we have not had proskuneo, we haven't heard from God. And you know, there's something about having an encounter with God. Because when you have an encounter with God, regardless of the situation, you still stand. Hallelujah. No matter what life throws at you, because you know God spoke. Hallelujah. So the first thing for you to be successful out there, according to Paul, he's saying by the Spirit of the Lord, saying that you got to prophesy, and that prophecy must come from proskuneo. Then he says, serve. And I encourage everyone to get the CDs and DVDs. Serve. You are out there to serve one another. We are out there to serve the government. We are out there to serve in different capacities. But it is through that God also blesses you. Then he says to teach. Teach. Express yourself. What you have received from God, take it out there. Apply it to your church. I mean your workplace. Apply it to your brothers and sisters, apply it to your children. Whatever you have heard, pass it on to faithful people. That is what the Lord instructs us to do. And then he says, encourage. Get a DVD on that too. You need to be an encourager. A lot of people don't encourage. A lot of people, when you are dying and you see them, you die more. But some people, when you are even dying and you got your last breath and you see them, somewhere, somehow, life, be that kind of person. Hallelujah. And it goes for us to be giving. We need to give, not just money. Love, time. Whatever you sow, you reap. Understand, whatever you sow, you reap. Some people go to churches and they said, oh, there's no love in the church. Hang on a minute. Who did you show love to? Because there's nobody you show love to that they will not show it back. Even if somebody doesn't want to smile, you smile at them. They smile if they don't know you. Go to Tesco, Sainsbury's, shopping. I mean, come and they just smile. They smile. One or two people will not, but majority will. So anytime you show kindness, somewhere, somehow, is they reciprocate. So we need to do that. Giving. The next thing we dealt with was leadership last week. It says that we have been called to lead. You may not be leading the capacity as a pastor, but you'll be leading in your sphere of influence. And leadership, really, where God is concerned, is about influence. Who are you influencing? And the thing is, I said last week, which is very dangerous, if you influence somebody and turn them away from God's purposes for their lives, you stand in harsh judgment from God. Moses did that. And it's very sad that this man served God faithfully all his years. And because he made that mistake he made, he could not go to the promised land. And you see, every time God calls you, he tells you your future. If he doesn't give you the detail, at least he gives you the general. And so God's intention was Moses to go to the promised land. Because if it wasn't his intention, when he called him, he would tell him that you will lead my people up to this point, and then I will take you from there. But he gave him all the detail that you will take them to the promise. He said you will take them to the promised land. That's what he told Moses. You come to Abraham when God called Abraham. He told him that your generations will go into slavery. And he told them 400 years. They ended up being there 430 years. But everything that would happen, even after he had died and gone, God made it clear to him. So God is the kind of God who will map your future and give you a glimpse of that future. And in the glimpse of the future Moses had, we didn't have any suggestion that he wasn't going to make it to the promised land. But unfortunately, because he messed up with his leadership, he influenced the people to not believe God at the very crucial point that God needed them to believe in him. So what leadership has God given you, and how are you using it? There are people that come into your life, they don't come into your life because you're handsome, you know. Or you are pretty, you know. Or you got good voice. Or you got good leadership skills. No, as a believer, anybody God brings into your life is divinely orchestrated to point them to God. He may have used your beauty to create their attention. He may have used your eloquence to create their attention. He may have used your degrees or qualifications to create their attention. But ultimately, that person came into your life for you to point them to God. In the church, we have done that. Messed up people's lives. Because you are a good singer and God gives you a lot of women to adore your music, you abuse them sexually. You will suffer for that. Because you are a pastor and God is giving you influence over the people, you abuse them because of the position. You will suffer for that. Any opportunity God gives you to influence somebody's life, if you cannot, just tell God, let this pass me by. But if you take that influence and you turn them against their own destiny that God has mapped for them, there's a harsh judgment. And that is why we have to be very careful how we respond to leadership out there. If you're a father, your place in your children's life is to show them that your God is Jehovah Jireh or Jireh. You are a small Jehovah Jireh in the house. And so as soon as you get these children to turn away from God because you are such a lousy father, you ask God to question their blood from you. So if you're a mother, God says, I'm El Shaddai, the big-breasted one. Colloquially put, the multi-breasted one, or the one with the multiplicity of nipples. Hallelujah. It means that I give nourishment. And as a mother, you give nourishment. Jesus gave us another dimension of God, being a woman. God is not just a man, you know. Let me just create a controversy. God is also a woman. Yes, I know the chauvinists wouldn't like that. But God is also a woman. In many cases, God expressed himself as a woman. God is sexless. We were created in his image. And remember, in his image was female and male. So God is not one-sided. He's very balanced. In God is female and male. And the Bible says that, he said, oh, Jerusalem, how I long to gather you. He was speaking about his feminine side. Like the mother hen gathers his children, but you will not let me. Mothers who cause segregation and separate their children because you have those children with 3, 4, 5 men, and at the end of the day, you like the last man more than the two previous ones. So the last one's children is what you are concerned with. And the other ones, you vilify them. You treat them so evil. And you bring divisions among your own children. Harsh judgment. So we have to be very careful the way we are. Hallelujah. Anytime God places you in a place of leadership, he is calling you to influence people to point to him. Today, we take the last one, which is mercy. Hallelujah. So 7 things that Paul puts across. We've dealt with all that. And I encourage you again, please get a CDs. And today we take mercy. We want to look at mercy in the marketplace. He says that if yours is mercy, show mercy with all diligence. Show mercy in everything you do. May I tell you then, church, is that God initiates mercy, but it's man who demonstrates and gives mercy. Let's take one scripture. John 20:19-23.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven."
This is Jesus speaking to his disciples. He appears to them. What a wonderful scene. It's like watching a sci-fi movie. And resurrected state appears to them. And he says, "Shalom." He showed them his hands and his side that was pierced. They were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. May the Lord bring us to that level. Amen. How many people would be overjoyed when they see a ghost? But that's okay. He said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you." And with that, he breathed on them. He went, "Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive the Holy Spirit on the apostles." Then what did he do? "If you forgive anyone's sin, their sins are forgiven." Who is talking here? And who is the one forgiving the sins? Good. "If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." So the exhibition of mercy is in the hands of the disciples. Let me develop it. Up until this point, it is God's prerogative. But the releasing of the Holy Spirit empowers man to either forgive sins or not forgive sins. If there is time, I'll show you why there's a lot of mess. Because people are living in unforgiveness and holding people back genuinely because they have offended them. And some people feel like they have to go forward with their life, but their lives are coming back because it's a mess. We have talked about grace, but we have not talked about the fact that grace is steeped in character. And it is your character that takes you to heaven. Because in heaven, you're not going to be robots. So God will have to rely on your character. So if you are a person of no character, begin to be careful because you might not go. And we are currently in examination. And the examination is this, that God is sifting who will be able to live with him and he will not have a headache. Let me develop it. I told you last week and I say it again. He says there were two on the field, one was taken, one was left. Two on the rooftop, one was taken, one was left. Two women at the mill grinding, one was taken, one was left. Then he comes back to look at eschatology, dealing with Roman and Matthew 24, 25, thereabout, because all that part of the test has to do with eschatology, that's the end time. And he's saying that there were 10 virgins, 5 foolish, 5 wise. And the 5 wise were the ones that made it because they had character. They had ability to think life through. They have ability to look at what is and they made it happen. Brothers and sisters, God called, but few are chosen. By that analogy Jesus made, it means that it's only 50% of the church or the so-called church that will be raptured. Some came to see some off. Some are just signboards pointing others to the kingdom. Paul puts it this way. He said that people preach the gospel out of strife. Some preach out of envy. He said at the end of the day, the gospel is what is preached. But it doesn't mean that those people themselves will be saved. Because everybody's work will go through fire. If it is made of hay, it shall burn out. If it is made of gold, it will be refined at the end of the day. So man is the one that gives mercy. God only initiates it. So at the end of the day, you can hold somebody to ransom and the person cannot prosper. That is why some of you curse people and it comes to pass. Because you didn't use mercy and because the people genuinely offended you. Bible says a curse without a cause will not stand. So if you curse somebody without a cause, forget it. But a curse with a cause will stand. That is why you don't want to offend anybody who is wicked. Hallelujah. God put mercy in the hands of the apostles. Certainly his apostles. Because God initiates mercy, but it's man who exercises it. It's clear in the text. Mercy started in the Garden of Eden. You see, when the time we look at the Garden of Eden story, it's a bit challenging, but let me see if I can be able to break it down a bit for us. You see, a father will not leave a cocked gun and put it among the toys of his child and tell the child, I'm going to the market. Don't touch the gun. That is irresponsible, father. I repeat, a father will not cock a gun and leave it among the toys of a vulnerable child and say to the child, don't touch this. I'm going to the market and I'll be back. No. So why do we thank God in that terms? And that is why I thank God for Jesus. Because he's the express image of God. He brought light to Genesis. Mercy started in Genesis. For the Bible says that when God had built the Garden of Eden, he placed man there. And he gave man the opportunity to eat the fruit of life or the tree of life. But number one, the Bible says that it was found in the garden. Another tree. Did God plant that tree? Every man of God is entitled to the opinion. But me, Shadrach Vusuari, I believe he didn't plant it. and I'll give you the reasons why. The Bible says that James said, let me quote the scripture because I want you to be able to, because this is a tough one. Let me quote the scripture for you. According to James 1:13.
When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone.
Now, James is the brother of Jesus. So he stayed with the man. He worked with the man. He did everything with the man. And I'm sure that he also told him so many things that were not privy to. And he's saying here that, number one, God doesn't tempt. And we know that the tree was there solely for the destruction of man. It is like somebody cocked a gun and put it among the toys for the child to play with. Why would God do that to a people he loves so much in a generation he's about to put across? So he's saying that, number one, you cannot tempt God. And two, God doesn't tempt us. He doesn't tempt us. So if we all accept the fact that the tree that was for temptation, then that alone tells you that then it is not God. It causes controversy right there. Let's do it for a second. Hallelujah. Jesus putting light into matters of life said, a one planted a garden. And the enemy came and sowed tares. By giving us the deep understanding that whatever God does, the enemy can also put his word, his fake, among it. Hallelujah. And then he says something very powerful. The apostle said that then we will go and uproot it. He said, don't touch it. But the angels, when it came to explain that test, will deal with it. And that which must be harvested will be harvested. And that which must be taken out will be taken out. So that answers the fact that God didn't remove that tree. Because he has in his own time what he was going to do with it. And so this is what may have happened. He plants and Satan creeps in and sows a bad seed in there. And by the way, that tree wasn't called the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The tree of knowledge of good and evil was written and described after man has sinned, just for your clarity and my clarity. But then when Eve spoke, this is what he said. He said that, don't touch that tree. There was no name to it. So now he plants it in there, and God realized what Satan has done, because that is his classic stuff. So he goes to them and he says that, don't touch it. Now I know what I am going to do in my own time. Just like Jesus put it, I am going to take it out. Now, when you realize where it talks about the tree in Genesis, a better translation will read, and it was found in the garden, the tree of knowledge of evil and good. So that gives us a, if it was found there, it's likely God put it there, or Satan put it there, or somebody put it there. And so if that is the case, and you look at what James has said, you look at what Jesus himself has said, and you look at the effect of the tree, it tells us that somebody was trying to mess up with man, but God went ahead of that person and gave man salvation regardless. Hallelujah. And so everything God does, Satan would like to do a counterfeit. We speak in tongues, Satan can't start speaking his own tongues. Are you hearing me? We claim a blessing, Satan tries it because he wants to be like God so badly. And he couldn't succeed. So now what he's doing is that he wants you and I to fail. So that he can tell God that, look at me, you put me out. And even the people that you put in place, they are not even good anyway. So when God put structures in place and he realized that this is what Satan has done, he didn't wait for the time to come. Before the foundations of the earth, he slew his own son. So that before anything could happen, your security and my security is measured. That is mercy. You are so privileged. I had only 5 people. I had only 10 people. I had only 20 people. I had only 30 people. I said, you are so privileged to be called a child of God. God put mercy after that in the hands of man, so that we can now work with one another and bring one another to a place of grace. And you see, one time I studied this story, it touches me further that as soon as they ate the tree, God dispatched the angels to protect the tree of life. You know why? Because Satan has caused these guys to fall. And now sicknesses and diseases and degradation and toil and horrible things are going to happen to man. If God didn't guard the tree of life, the next thing Satan was going to do is to cause them to go and eat the tree of life, and they will never be able to die. And you know what will happen? Adam and Eve will still be alive today. Abraham and everyone, they will still be alive today, but not in the condition like you and I are in. They'll be ridden with diseases and sicknesses. They'll be ridden with stuff, people suffering from AIDS, people suffering from cancer, people suffering from all manner of terrible diseases. They will not be able to die. And yet their bodies will be maggot ridden and they will not die. And the love God has got for you and the love is God for me, he just protects. Nobody could touch it. And come to Revelation. It says that when he cleansed humanity with the blood, and now we are perfected, he now brought the tree of life. He said, now we can eat the tree of life, and we will not ever die. But at the same time, there will never be sickness, diseases, everything else. That is the mercy of God. That is always accessible to us. But how do we respond to that mercy? That is what I want to share with you in the next few minutes. The problem we have, brothers and sisters, is that we lack understanding that when we don't forgive our brothers and sisters and we don't show them mercy, we hold them back. I repeat, we hold them back. But that shouldn't be an incentive for you to say, oh, Pastor, if that is the case, I have people to hold them back. Because if you misuse any virtue that God has given you, you account for it. I remember when we became born again and, you know, we're on fire of the Lord and stuff, that we prayed certain prayers that we regretted. Yes. I know this man of God, for instance, he stopped a taxi and the taxi didn't stop. And for the fact that the taxi didn't stop, he was so mad, he cursed the taxi. I'll tell you, this is not a story. It happened within a few years after that, all the four tires, like that. I said, what kind of power is this that you use to burst people's tires? That power that bursts those tires can resurrect somebody from the dead. But that is not the exhibition of mercy. Are you hearing me? That is not the exhibition of mercy. People get offended and they wish the heaven open and strike people dead. That is not mercy. And yes, the person is guilty as charged. But the point is that you are not releasing your brother or your sister. That is why God says that even though I've given you the authority, leave it up to me. Hallelujah. Leave it up to me. You've got to show mercy to people, especially those designed to be part of your destiny. Sometimes those who are part of your destiny, they are the people that you'll be tempted never to show them mercy because they offend you so badly. Let me give you a typical example. Jesus understood that Peter was part of his destiny. And he also understood that Judas was part of his destiny, but in a different way. So look at the two scenarios. When it was time for Judas to do what he has to do, he turns to Judas and says, what you have to do, do it what? Quickly. But with Peter, when Satan sought to sift him, he rebuked Satan and protected him. And I love the story. It wasn't John. If you look at the way Jesus was with his people, he should have left the church in charge of John. He loved John. John loved him. They were bosom buddies. A guy sleeping on the bosom of another guy. That tells you how close buddies they were. But he realized that John hasn't got spine. He wanted somebody with spine. And look at Peter. Peter denies Jesus. Peter is the one that drew the sword. Peter is the one. But you see, God realized that this man has a good heart. So I'm going to show him mercy. There are people around you, they have got big mouth, but let me tell you, they've got big heart for you. They may have made some mistakes. Don't go cursing people. Sometimes we get hurt, especially pastors, and then we curse people. Don't ever do that, pastors. Because some people, what they do, they don't even understand it. And one day, their scale will fall off their eyes. And when they fall off their eyes, they need to repent and do what they did. And if you curse them, you don't curse your children. Show them mercy. I was in an ethics class, and sorry I'm bringing this publicly, but it was a very interesting thing that we're talking about. We're talking about ethics, and people were just moving about that and stuff like that. And the issue was that if you have a daughter, and the daughter is promiscuous, are you going to give the daughter a condom to protect herself, or are you going to say that you can go and the Lord punish you? And I'm of the school that says that give her a condom. Let make sure that she protects herself. And some people were against my argument. And I said, listen to me. If your view is to get your child born again, do you want her to be dead before she gets born again? So whatever you can do to keep her alive till she encounters God, you've got to do it. The fact that you give her that material doesn't mean that you're supporting her lifestyle. It doesn't mean that you're telling her that it is right to do that. But you say that because you're not listening to me, at least protect yourself. Have longevity of life. Maybe between now and the day that God encounters you, you will still be alive so that you can turn the clock around. There's so much wickedness in the church that we frame it in morality and we frame it in spirituality by stupidity. Glory to God. We got to show mercy. I mean, how many people would turn to somebody who just denied you? I don't know about you, but I find it tough. And it wasn't even before the Sanhedrin. Not before the big guys, pastor. Just before a small girl. I don't know him. And the next time the person is coming close to you, hey, traitor, get away. But he showed him mercy. In fact, Peter was shocked when he turns up at the seashore by the Galilee. And then he prepares some breakfast. He said, come, let us eat. That was a salt covenant. And whilst they were eating, he said, take care. He said, me? But I. In fact, let me backtrack. When he resurrected, he said, go and tell my brethren. And Peter. Wow. You can imagine when they came to tell the story, Peter was like, oh no, I have done a terrible thing. And I said, but he mentioned your name. I said, are you sure? Yes. He said, we should go and tell him, and you. He said, are you sure he mentioned my name? Oh yes, he didn't mention anybody. You were the person he mentioned. You could imagine the joy, the restoration that he felt in his heart. And then second, he meets him at the seashore. And he said, come and eat with me. Let's make a salt covenant. He said, feed my lamb, feed my sheep, feed my sheep. And listen to this. When he has said that, he didn't use the word agape. He didn't use agape. Sometimes it's better to read the scriptures from the Greek point of view. He uses the word philia. Even though the English version translates, do you love me, do you love me, do you love me? It says philia, agape philia. And what does it mean? He said, do you put me above everyone else? He said, Lord, you know. Now you're making me feel bad. He said, no. I need to drive this out of you. Because even though you made those mistakes, I know you got a good heart for me. It's not everybody that offends you who is against you. Because we are in this material body, we'll make wrong decisions. Sometimes we will be pressured to say things we shouldn't say. Sometimes even marriage, One person gets angry and says something. And he comes, I'm really sorry. No, you're not sorry. You are not sorry. You are not sorry. If I've been with you all these years, I've served you food, had your babies, and this is what you said to me, but I am, so what? You are not. You will live to regret this, I tell you. But I'm genuinely, you are, don't come close to me. You are not sorry. It means it came from your heart. It means you brooded over it for years. It means all these 20, yay! World, we are saying world. You are not sorry. But genuinely, he is sorry. But genuinely, she is sorry. Because sometimes we can be pushed to do things we shouldn't do. That is why God says that I check the heart of people. You see, if the heart of a person is wrong, everything else is wrong. If the heart of the person is right, some things can be wrong. But initially, things are not wrong from the heart. When people have offended you, show mercy. Especially if they are part of your destiny. Some people are struggling in their marriages today. Not because they married the wrong person, but because of the things they did in their past. Some people are suffering certain ways today. Not because they are evil, but because the message they didn't show before. Some people even are not happy in their workplace. Not because they are bad people, but because they didn't show mercy. And I've made decisions that is really affecting them. There is also a twist to mercy. And that twist to mercy is steeped in integrity and fairness. So let me take the next few minutes just to give you some practical aspects of mercy. The first, when you buy from the shop and they give you a change that is over, what do you do with it? But you know what people say? The Lord is good. Miracle. Miracle. And we spiritualize it. But we don't realize that the person at the till will be made to pay for it. You haven't shown mercy to that person. And sometimes the conditions will be set that it's better to take the money away. It has happened to me before. I'll confess to you. I was in IKEA. And they did something that was, I've forgotten the story now, but something to the effect of about £200 or something like that. So when I was leaving, I got to the door and I realized what has happened. And I was in a hurry. So somebody said to me, "You are in a hurry. It's okay. Go." And then my moral self said, "No, don't do it. Go back." So I was in a dilemma for a few minutes. Should I go? Should I not go? My sinful self said, "Go." And I've got a legitimate reason because I was in a hurry. And then my moral side says, "Don't do that. Go back." So finally, I listened to my moral side. And I got there. When I got there, the customer, whatever, there's a long queue. You know, the devil or circumstance will play in such a way that what you need to do right, you will justify yourself not to do it. There was a cue. Then I'm like, "Oh no." Still, my moral side was speaking. Stay in the queue. My sinful side was saying that, "Go." I said, "No, I'm going to stay." Funny enough, just when I said I'm going to stay, another till opened. And so a lot of the guys moved there. Then the person in front of me, two persons in front of me. This is a very interesting story. The woman was so rude to that person because I think he was returning an item and it wasn't whatever it was. But he was so rude. I mean, she was so rude. And so he's standing there saying that even the person I want to help, she's so rude. Why should I? Did you see how the devil works? So from the gate back to the queue, just about one person or two persons to reach the. I have another reason not to even do that, because the woman was so rude. I'm preaching. And I tell you something. I must be honest with you. My moral side and my sinful side were in a big fight. And I was like, let me just walk away. I said, no, don't. So finally, I get there. And I told the girl, I think you made a mistake with this stuff. This and that, I just made it. Oh, you should see her. Oh, thank you very much. Oh, how many people would do this? Oh, this and that and that. I tell you something, sir. If you hadn't brought that, I'll be made to pay for it. I'll be made to pay. I thank you so much for your honesty and everything else. And I said, don't worry, just work it out. And then it turned, I walked away. The relief. Somebody will be made to pay 200 something pounds. And for all you know, she only earns about 200 pounds a week. So that week's salary is gone because she made a mistake. And because you are aware. And then you give it to the Lord. The Lord has blessed me. The Lord hasn't blessed you. You have stolen from someone. Show mercy. And you know that your actions are going to disadvantage somebody. You got to show what? Mercy. You get home early. Be fair. And cook. Don't wait for her. I'm preaching on. I'm preaching on. Show mercy. Are you understanding that? You went to work from 6 o'clock in the morning. She also went to work from 6 o'clock in the morning. Somewhere, somehow, you usually come at 6, but somewhere, somehow, you were released to come home early, so you got there around 4 o'clock. You don't wait for her to come at 6 to go to the kitchen and stand on her feet for another 2 hours to prepare you a meal. I don't know why African meals take so long, but... Show mercy. Hallelujah. Surprise her. Glory to God. By the time she comes, the food is ready. You sat on the table and everything else. He said, darling, I came home early today. And I said, today, don't worry cooking. I cook for you. Amino. Glory to God. Show mercy. Hallelujah. Some people, they must insist. Where I come from, we Ashanti men, we eat fufu in the morning. We Yoruba men, we like our eba. But it's not conducive to cook fufu in the morning. Not even eba. Can you do with cornflakes? Because we are not back home. We are not in our own territory when you can have male servants and all those things, do things like that. Now it is just you and her. So do things to alleviate the pain. Hallelujah. Be fair. Glory to God. Amen. 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 She is so tired. And she said, I'm not tonight, honey. Be fair. Let him that have got an ear hear what the Spirit is saying. Amen. Glory to God. You know she has been working very hard. You know that she had to pick the kids up. You know that she was called to work to do some stuff. You know she is tired. Just take a cold shower and let it be a rain check for another day. 3, pay your fair share of the bills and be merciful to the one who carries the burden. It's amazing. You're only sojourning in the house because the man or the woman hasn't asked you to pay bills. And he's saying that you can live here until you get your flat or you get yourself sorted. You leave the heater on. You are in the living room and still the heater is on in your bedroom. The light is on 24/7. You are going out, the light is on. Because you are not the one who pays. You go to the bathroom. These days, houses have got meters. So they've got meters. You go to the bathroom and you leave the shower on. When you are scrubbing, you still have the shower on. No. Wash. Turn it off. Scrub. After scrubbing, turn it on. Then rinse. Some, they have pre-shower, during shower, post-shower. Pre-shower, they go to the bathroom and they turn the heat, the thing on, and they get the gauge right, and they go like this. Okay. And then all this time, the thing is just running, and the meter is going clock, 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 because it's not the one that pays. Be merciful. And then, okay. Okay, now first rinse, and then you step out, and then now sponge. The thing is still running, and it takes about 10 minutes to sponge. Here, it doesn't take much attention. There, much attention. By the time you get to the toe, about 50 gallons are already gone. And you don't have any compassion for the person. Are you hearing me? You come to the kitchen. He's told you, you can live as long as you want. You go into the, you get the milk. You know you can only drink half a glass. And you turn full glass. And then you drink and the rest, you just chuck it in the bin. You are not being considerate. You are not being merciful. Maybe the person may not be able to say it. But you have to help the person. That if I cannot give you monetary value blessing, if I cannot give you something concerning my sojourning in this house, at least let me be very mindful that especially in a place like London, where we even tax on our breathing. Do you know you get taxed on your breathing? Yeah, there is congestion, pollution tax. Yeah, there's pollution tax. So you are taxed on your breathing. You are also taxed on your water you drink. And then when you also taxed on the waste. Very soon your liver, your pancreas, your everything will be taxed one after the other. Oh boy, I thought I could finish this. Be merciful. The one who carries the burden. Be merciful to your pastor. Be merciful to your pastor in your attitude towards church responsibilities. There is no pastor that is perfect. There is no church that is perfect. And trust me, if you find a church that is perfect, as soon as you join it, it becomes imperfect. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Be merciful. You don't want your pastor to grow gray before his time. You don't want the leaders to be crying, so you've got to do your bit. Hallelujah. Some people just don't care. They sit on the chairs anyhow. The place I've been giving you to sit, why do you sit on the arm? And then you sit on them and I, and then you know what happened? I saw somebody. I saw them, the person. I looked at the person, I laughed in my head. I said, the devil in you is working. You know, I mean, it would be nice to go to the maintenance team and tell the maintenance team that I'm really sorry, I sat on the edge and please, I broke the chair. So, not that we'll let you pay for it, but at least you inform somebody so it can be repaired or something. No! They said, don't chew gum in the church. The reason why we say don't chew gum, not because there are demons in the gum. But the temptation you have to take the gum and put it on the chair and all that kind of stuff. Hallelujah. Amen. So be merciful. Be merciful in the way you treat the bathroom. By the time you go there and you turn out, you say, No, leave it the way you saw it. And if you didn't see it in a good state, make it better. Only five people are clapping. As Bishop John said the other day, how many people, even when they go home, they call pastor and say that, "Pastor, was tithe and offering good today? Is there any problem?" No. But we all have to learn to do that. That we give our quota. So that Sunday after Sunday, you come and meet church. So that the mortgages are paid, the rent is paid, so your pastor doesn't get bald head. The judge is clapping very hard. And I know he does, because sometimes he puts his own personal money into the coffers. Yeah. When offering is not enough, when it snowed and people didn't come to church, or it rained, or some weather element happens and people don't come to church, the bills don't tell you, or the BT or whatever don't tell you that because you didn't get good offering, you must pay. And they threaten you with what? Bailiffs and stuff like that. So you got to understand that be merciful, that what you are receiving from church, that you yourself call a blessing, make sure you sustain it. Make sure God is not saying, empty your account and bring it. Just say that you just pay your tithe and your offering, and I will look for the rest and bless you back. He says, do that. Just that will be fine. Hallelujah. Be merciful to your pastor. Be merciful to your church leadership and give your quota through your offerings. And then leadership decisions. You see, things that rock the boat unnecessarily, you've got to be careful about that. I told the church this morning in Peckham, and I was saying to people that a lot of times offense will breed witchcraft. And so anytime you feel offended in something or someone, straight away deal with it. Because as soon as it turns into witchcraft, it will affect you. And may I tell you, church, that God is jealous and zealous about his church. He will not let anybody destroy his church. He said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So anybody that stands against God's purpose, God will deal with. And that is why you and I have to be very careful what we say and how we act. It is sad that John the Baptist of all people, who led the way for Christ, because Malachi said that before the Messiah comes, the Elijah must come. He was so offended. We don't know why he was offended. But theologians and people believe that because Jesus didn't visit him at the prison. And some also believe that because Jesus had powers, obviously, to make things appear and disappear, he could have just released him out of prison just like that. Jesus didn't do it. And you know, he waited to question the credibility of Jesus. He could have gone in the secret of the night. He could have made his people call him to the side. When Jesus was in public ministry, with everybody looking on and blessing them, then his disciples went there and they asked him, are you the Messiah, or should we expect another? Oh, hang on a minute. John, you are the one that baptized me. You are the one that publicly said that you saw heaven open and the doves came down, representing the Holy Spirit. You are the one that said that I am not worthy to even touch the touch of the sandals. You said all those things, but because of offense, offense now led into witchcraft. This is Jesus' answer. He said, I will not let anybody be offended in me. In other words, I will not let John the Baptist be offended in me. But what did you go out there to see? What did you go out into the desert to see? A reed shaken by the wind? No. Those who wear good raiment are in king's palaces. What did you go out there to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, more than a prophet. But the least in the kingdom is greater than John. Demoted straight away. The least in the kingdom is greater than John, all because of offense. And you don't realize that when you are offended, you destroy what you have built. And you're thinking that, okay, my offense can now let me get people on my side. You are not fighting anybody. If there's anybody you are fighting, it is God. So he's telling us there that integrity and fairness must rule. When your brother offends you, make sure that you deal with the offense, because if you don't deal with it, it will turn into witchcraft. When your sister offends you, when your pastor offends you, when your worker, co-worker offends you, when somebody offends you in your workplace, never ever allow offense. God had to allow the giant, what is his name again? Goliath, to be offended in David. And that broke his power. Offense. So he bewitched himself. He looked at David, and I like what Justin said this morning in the reflection. He looked at David, and he was so offended. That if I've asked you to bring a match for me, moi, big fighter, me that I am a field marshal, and you bring me a private. What is the lowest rank in the army? A private. Field marshal. And I'm telling you, bring me another field marshal so we can get on it. And you bring me a private. I'm so offended. They said, And when you come also, what are you coming with? Sticks or what is it called again? Stones, sling. But you see, as soon as he got offended in David, his guards broke down. So he realized that there is no need even for me to use my javelins and everything else, because with this boy, I would just pick him. Because he was about 9 foot, and just break him in two like this. Boom. It would not be no contest. And David also looked at him. And he said, you come against me with javelins and spears and everything else, but I come against you the name. The God of the Israelites, whom you defy. I will give your flesh to the carcass, your carcass to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. Why? Because he understood. David was not offended in him, but he was trusting in God. When somebody calls you to be offended, straight away sit up. I said, this is an entrapment for my destruction. It could be your wife, it could be your husband, it could be your pastor, it could be your boss at work, it could be what have you. Anybody that causes you to be offended, don't ride on the fence. Straight away sit up and say, I will not let any myopic mind, I will not let anybody send me into the bitterness of offense. Because the next thing that is going to happen is witchcraft. And when witchcraft happens, your death follows. Because it says, suffer no witch to live. Shall we rise? Mercy. Turn to somebody and say, mercy. We got to walk in mercy. We just got to walk in mercy. We got to treat one another with mercy. I said earlier and I say it again. It's not everybody. It's not everybody that is evil. Some people may offend you, but that doesn't mean they are evil. Some with genuineness of their heart, they make mistakes. If Jesus looked at the dealings of Peter, he would have knocked him off. But he understood Peter. He understood Peter. Your wife loves you, that's why he married you. Your husband loves you, that's why he married you. Your mother loves you. That's why she fed you all these years. Now you're a big boy. If she was a witch, she'd have used you for shish kebab. Long time ago. You know, sometimes this foolishness we experience in the body, you know, foolishness. 45 years old. It's my mother. My mother is a witch. It's because, she fed you and look after you. So you are 45. She didn't chew you. Somebody say mercy. We need a lot of mercy. I want us to just take 2 minutes to pray. Pray concerning this word. Pray concerning this word. Because mercy is entrenched in the hand of the believer. And how do we do that? God willing, next week, Sunday, we'll deal with it. When the Lord said very clearly in the text that whatever sin you forgive, it's forgiven. And whatever sin you don't forgive, now he's talking about you and I. How does that work? What can we forgive and what can we not forgive? And you'd be amazed to know that there are a lot of people who are not prospering because of you. Because you are still holding them. And God can't do anything about it unless you release them. There are certain things God cannot do unless he finds a man. And this is one of them. That is why the Bible says that when Jacob was about to die, he called all his children and looked into the eyes of Reuben. And he said, Reuben, from today on, you die. I'm not showing you mercy because you went into your father's bed and slept with my concubine. Bible says that from that day on, Reuben died. God didn't do anything about it. Their men were few. Nothing happened for Reuben until Moses. It was Moses, as an apostolic father, that turned things around. The man actually took his child's blessing to the grave. And you know how he did it? He waited when he was about to die. So there will be no chance for Reuben to go and call elders to come even beg him. Bible says when he was about to die, kneeling on his staff, all sons of Jacob, sit down, let me tell you your future. Starts with the firstborn. You were cursed. This is what you do. And this man did that thing many years ago. The man didn't say anything. He kept it. As soon as he finished cursing them and everything, that he died. That is wickedness. Some of you, your fathers have holding your blessings because they didn't show you mercy. You need an apostolic father to undo what your father did. Some of your father just sat in the sitting room, look at you and say, you will suffer. Because God has placed in the hand of man. It's not in his hands, it's in the hand of man. So Moses caught it, and Moses said, unless we could deal with it, Moses said, Reuben, the curse that was placed on you by your father, the only person that can undo it is another father. And now I stand in apostolic grace, so I undo the curse. And from now on, you will be blessed. From now on, you will increase. From now on, your men will not be few. From now on, things will happen for you. Do you know what? At the end of the day, he was the first to get his inheritance because Moses turned it around. Any curse that has been spoken over your life, in the name of Jesus, we turn it around by the might of the Holy Spirit. And I want to declare to anybody here who is holding somebody's future, who is holding somebody back, release the person. Because if you don't release the person, God will question you. Release the person. Let them go. Let them go. Show them mercy. Show them mercy because God showed you mercy. It's because you are not showing them mercy, that's why they're not getting married. It's because you're not showing them mercy, that is why things are happening. I know situations where boyfriends and girlfriends, things that happen among them, one person held the other one, the person has been single all their life. Because the person has put the feet down. And it's legitimate. Because a curse without a cause will not stand. But a curse with a cause will stand. So there's legitimacy there. Taking my money. We will see. Talking about that, I think I have to release somebody. I release the person in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Kabo Shedadaba. I release. Take the money. Amen. Hallelujah. Release the person. We cry. I've got to go to the altar. Shall we pray? Lift up your voice and pray. Pray, 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 pray. If you are holding somebody, release the person. Release the person right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your power. We thank you for your mind, and we thank you for your revelation. That Lord God, who will release me? Who will pray to mercy? So mercy will triumph over judgment. We thank you for your grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our mission is raising overcomers, setting the captives free. Freedom Center International is here to support you in every step that you take with the Word of God as you seek spiritual and emotional wholeness. And we hope you've been blessed by today's message. Worship with us at 38 Upper Wickham Lane, Welling, Kent, DA16 3HF, or give us a call on 0207-277-8700. You can also visit us online at fcichapel.org. And remember, there is progress in freedom.